Yeah, welcome to our next exercise of the lecture Pattern Recognition and Machine Learning. Today's topic is neural networks. Today we are talking at first about a small review of neural networks. Afterwards we discuss some comprehension questions, and at last I will show you some examples in Python. Okay, let's start with the introduction to neural networks. For that we have to answer the question, what are neural networks? So neural networks are based on our human brain, in which we have cells. Those cells are called neurons, and those neurons are connected to each other in a very special way that give us the ability to think and to remember. So if we want to mimic those connections, we have the model of a perceptron. So perceptron is just a model of those. So we have a big circle. This is mimics a neuron which has many inputs. For example, this here and here. Those inputs are called x0, x1, xn minus 0. So we have a lot lot of inputs, and each of those inputs have a special weighting. For example, w0, w1, wn minus 1, and those are going into our neuron. In our neuron, we have a special activation function, fact, that it's doing some stuff with specific inputs. For example, it has a Dirac function or just a linear fit, something like that. For that, we have our x times w's. And afterwards, we get one output, and this output is h of, for example, 0. So this is a very basic idea of our perceptron. If we have inputs, we calculate some values, and afterwards we get an output. And this is a very, very basic idea of a neuron. So if we connect many of those together, we can build our neural network. If you want to learn more about the basic idea of this and the more hardware near solution for that, you can listen to Professor Kohlstedt and his lectures, Neuromorphic Engineering. Okay, now we can come to the second part, the implementation of such a neural network. For that we need to train a neural network that we afterwards can apply in runtime environment. At first, I will talk to you with this diagram about training, and afterwards we can talk about the runtime implementation. So if we want to look at the training part, we have to look at the red part of this diagram. We start at the bottom left. So we have this database with input and output features. The important part is that we have the output features to our input features, so we know what we want to extract from those, for example, pictures or speech signals. So x is our signal that goes into our neural network. When we train, this connection is closed and we don't have this unknown database with features. So our x of n goes into our neural network and our training algorithm. Afterwards, we have some output of those training algorithm that depends on the error. The error is calculated in this part of our training algorithm, and it calculates the distance between our output of our neural network, that is y tilde, and our known good y of n. So if we have a perfect neural network and the output, the estimated output y tilde of n is exactly like y of n, the error would be zero, and we would pretty much have no training necessary anymore because output is exactly the same. So we can define our efficiency of our neural network with this error coefficient. And with this error, we can also train our neural network. So if the distance between those two y and y tilde of n of those signals is too big or is bigger than zero, we train or we adapt our training with this signal and calculate new weights, for example, for our neural network. Yeah, and that's pretty much the basic version of training. If we have trained our neural network and the distance of the estimated and the real known output features are the same, we can apply it in a runtime environment. So this is the green part of this diagram. And you can pretty much guess it. We just put our unknown, or not unknown, but our input features in our neural network. And that neural network will do its stuff. So it calculates some our output feature, our desired output feature. And afterwards, we pretty much have to trust the neural network that those output features are pretty much the best output feature that you get with those input features. Okay, now we can come into more detail about our neural network. So we now know that we have our input feature x of n. This input feature is some sort of a database vector of input features. And this could be, for example, for speech, something like the pitch frequency, or for images, it could be some sort of a RGB value or something like that. And those input features are get processed in our neural network. We can basically put our neural network into three basic layers. So we have at first the input layer. This is a little bit special because there we can just do some sort of normalization, something like that. Afterwards, we have many, or at least, not at least one, but maybe a few hidden layers. They are pretty much the same in the sense that they are they can vary in size, but the basic calculations in the hidden layers are the same. And at last, we have the output layer. This output layer will convert our intermediate results and store or convert them into our desired output features. And our output features are in this case our y hat of n. Now we can come to the first layer, the input layer. The input layer can have some special properties. For example, we can do some sort of normalization. This is depicted in this subtraction of the mean of this special feature. So we subtract the mean of the feature x0 and have afterwards normalized signal when we also divide by the standard deviation. So we can normalize our input signals and make them more equal. This is for neural networks interesting because if we have, for example, one feature that has a very, very small amplitude and want to extract from that information, but also have another feature that has very big amplitudes and very big variation in it. That is very hard for the neural network to learn because we have such high deviation in those signals. So if we normalize our input signals, we can train faster our neural network. We don't have to do this. You can also have just a pass-through layer where we just multiply with ones and just take our normal feature vectors. This depends heavily on the task and on the signals or features that we want to analyze in our neural network. Okay, the second layer I want to discuss with you is the hidden layer. The hidden layer is basically the most not common, but the most layer that is used in neural network because we use it everything else beside the input and the output layer. So for that we have our input of the hidden layer. This is h0 of n in this case. And this vector, or this feature vector, is multiplied with our weights vector, w0 of 0. So the weights vector for the first, for the hidden layer 0, and then the first feature 0, so w0, 0. And after multiplication, we can also add in bias to this number. This is done in training. Maybe we don't want to add a bias, then this would be 0. And afterwards, we can put this result of those two terms in our activation function. And afterwards, we get pretty much the result from the activation function. So as activation functions, there are a ton. There are many, many activation functions that we can choose of. The basic idea of an activation function is the idea of this perceptron. So the very basic version of the activation function, for example, is such short of the threshold. So we add all of those weights, not weights, but all of those results together. And if the result exceeds a certain threshold, we, for example, fire our output, so our output gets from 0 to 1. This would be a very basic activation function. But the basic differences of activation functions are the range in which they operate. For example, we have some that are from minus infinity to infinity, so the output could be infinity. Some others are from 0 to 1. And stay one, doesn't matter what how big the input is. So this range is pretty much the only difference in those activation functions, and are also important for our neural network. So if we have such activation functions that could go to infinity, we have to be careful because our neural network could be get unstable or something like that, because we could get really big numbers. Now we can come to our last layer, the output layer. The output layer is just the last layer that we have in our neural network. And the input of our output layer is the vector hm of n. So our just the last output of our last hidden layer, where m is the number of hidden layers we have in our neural network. And what we can do is we can calculate some sort of normalization, or we can limit our output. So if we say we want our h hat of n, a y hat of n, to be in a certain range, for example plus minus 1 or something like that, we could just calculate the minimum and the maximum and normalize our outputs. This is important when we have specific output features that we want to have in a specific range. Okay, now we can come to special types of neural networks. I will talk briefly about convolutional neural networks and recurrent neural networks. In this diagram, we have a convolutional neural network. And in this example, we have an input, and picture as an input. So our picture has 32 by 32 by 1 pixels, and is our input feature vector. So we have 32 by 32 features that are 1024 individual values. Afterwards, we can convert those input features, and convolutional neural networks are often using some sort of pooling mechanism to do that. So for example, if we have our pictures with one, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, 9 pixels. We want to reduce the size of this picture, and for example, use 4, a sliding window, which will take 4 of those pixels, and for example calculate the mean of those pixels. So afterwards we could have something like this, where we just calculate mean of those 4 pixels And this will give our a new value for a smaller image size. Afterwards, we can calculate the mean of those four pixels. And with this method, we can reduce our feature size. And by applying smart or good pooling algorithms, we can exactly use it for edge detection or something like that. So in this example, we reduce our layer size each time. So 32 by 32 gets smaller and to 28 by 28 times 6, and so on. So reduce in each step our image. And afterwards, we will go to a very, very small vector with 10 by 1 by 1. And from that, we can, for example, conclude some sort of a trained output feature. What this is doing is also reducing the size of our neural network. In theory, we could do this with the whole picture, so we don't reduce the data size by pooling and just use a very, very big neural network in this case. But this will take ages to train and don't need to be very good because we maybe have some sort of a overfitting or something like that. So convolutional neural networks are pretty old in the sense of neural networks, and but are still a very good choice, for example, image processing. Okay, now we can come to the second special type of neural networks. This is a recurrent neural network. The recurrent neural network is a little bit newer than the convolutional neural network and has some special properties. The beginning is pretty much the same as a normal neural network. So we have our input vector x of n that has our input features, and those are getting feed into our input layer. The input layer is pretty much calculating the normal stuff, for example, normalization or something like that. And afterwards, we have our output of the input layer. This is h of 0, and this is fed into our hidden layer. The hidden layer is a little bit special in our case because the name says it extended hidden layer. It has more inputs than our hidden layers before. So we can see it in this path. We have another input that is just a delayed version of our output of the hidden layer. So this will give the overall neural network some sort of a memory. So we have the temporal component in our neural network also in it. And this has some nice properties because we can, although the recurrent neural network can learn some sort of patterns of temporal patterns and can classify them, for example. Afterwards, after some hidden layers, we have our output layer, and this output layer is just doing normal output layer stuff and calculates, for example, also some sort of limitation or something like that. And we have our normal output feature vector y hat of n. Okay, now if we looked at special types of neural networks, now we can have a look at the training of neural network. For that, we look into two versions, for example, the backpropagation, which is depicted on this slide. And afterwards, I will show you two versions with generative adversarial networks. So backpropagation is pretty much the classic version of or to train a neural network. So if we look at our neural network here, our neural network here, we have our normal layers. We have our normal input x of n, and we calculate our desired or estimated output features y hat of n. When we want to train our neural network, we know pretty much both. So we know our y hat of n. This is the picture below. We know our y hat of n, and we know our x of n. What we don't know is our neural network. So we want to calculate our neural network between weights, the biases, maybe even the normalization and the activation functions. So for that, we go in the backwards direction. So we give our neural network our output, our later output, our y hat of n, and calculate or optimize it in the sense that we want to optimize our x of n. This is often done by minimizing a cost function, and this is pretty much every time the gradient descent method, where we just go in the steepest descent of our gradient. And this will take some time and also needs some requirements for our activation function, for example. This activation function, for example, must be continuous and also differentiable. Because this takes some time, we don't do it in runtime. Or if we do it in runtime, we often do it in the side or by the side. So we maybe want to have a very cool neural network that adapts over time and that needs some training over time, but this is often done in the background. And afterwards we hopefully have our trained neural network that we can just apply in our real scenario. Okay, let's come to the second version of training a neural network. This would be the idea of generative adversarial networks, or short GANs. In GANs we have two neural networks that are in a special order. We have at first the generator network, that is pretty much the basic neural network that we talked already before. So we have our normal input x of n and our normal output y hat of n. Just calculates the neural network stuff. The second neural network is a discriminator network. This discriminator network has the task to decide if the input of it, so this part, is generated by the generator network, so if it's y hat of n or y of n. And the decision is randomly chosen by this d of n. So sometimes we have really the y of n, and sometimes the y hat of n. So the idea of that, of GANs, is that we train our neural network and try to convict our generator network with the discriminator network and see if the output is really true, so y of n, or is it just a bad version of it, y hat of n. And if the discriminator network doesn't really find a difference between those two outputs, we know that our generator network is pretty good, because we can't really tell the difference between those outputs. The training of those two types, or of GANs and those two neural networks, is done in an alternating fashion. So we first one try to get it better, afterwards we train the second neural network and try to get it better, and so on. Okay, now let's come to the comprehensive questions. So the first question is, what importance does the database have for the success of the training process? What requirements should a training database fulfill? So for that, we have to think about the training of a neural network. So a neural network trains on a database, on a known database, and can only know things or learn things that are based in this database. So all of those known cases which are used for learning need to be representative. So we have representative, and this means that we have all cases in it. We know, or we can't expect something from the neural network that is not in the database. Second part is it should be just simply large enough. So we need to have enough pictures to train or pictures, for example, to train our neural network and to get all sorted out. So if we have some noise in it or something like that, this needs to be large enough to boil down to the important parts. Okay, the second question is, what is meant by the term overfitting and what countermeasure is usually taken to prevent this? So overfitting means that our database is either too small or we trained our neural network too long. So overfitting means that we know all of our training data. So the neural network exactly knows which picture, for example, is one of those training datas and knows for this picture the output is so and so. So this is just a problem of either the size of the training data or the length of the training. The second question is, what countermeasure is usually taken to prevent this? This is pretty easy. We just split our database in three parts. The first one would be training, where we just do the normal training bit. Afterwards, evaluation and testing at last. So we train our neural network with a specific set of a database. If we think we trained enough, we are doing some evaluation to check if our convergence is fulfilled. And the last part would be just for testing the performance of our neural network. Okay, another question is, what is the role of the random generation block in the GAN training process, and why is the squared classification error of the discriminator network at one point minimized and another point maximized? So the first part of the question is, what is this part doing here? It's pretty much just a random generator that randomly decides if the discriminator network sees the estimated, so the y hat of n as input or the original y of n as input. This gives the decision of the discriminator network the base, because we want that the discriminator network does not know which input it has from other things. So this decision has to be random. So it's truly a classification or a discrimination of the real signals. The second part of the question is why do we minimize and maximize another point? For that, we have to look into the training part of the GAN network. So I said that we train the discriminator network and the generator network in alternative fashion. So we at first train, for example, the generator. And if we train the generator network, we want to maximize the output of the discriminator network, so the output of the error, and therefore need to maximize the error between d and d hat of n. If we want to train the discriminator network, we need to keep the generator network fixed and want to minimize the difference between d and d hat of n. So the goal is that the discriminator network is optimized to both inputs y and y hat of n. Yeah, let's go to the last part of this exercise, the Python demo. For that, we prepared some Python code for you and also a small task list that you can work on. So the first task is to visit the playground. So TensorFlow offers a website where you can click and point at some basic structures of neural network and play around with the parameters. That's good to learn some impact of some of those parameters. Yeah, the second part is some Python code itself that we provided you on our website. This is done with Keras, and there are two examples. The one on the one hand, the classification example, where we generate some data, and we want to classify it in certain regions. And afterwards, the second example is regression. So we want to look into two data sets and have a look if they depend on itself or not. Afterwards, I will go to the classification example itself. There you have to, or you can work on your own. So we have a normal DIY exercise and a solution afterwards. And this exercise, you do it, you do a classification on a data set on its own. But I will talk about this in a minute. And the last part is a DIY exercise for regression. There you have or generate also a data set and have a look into different dependency on this data. Okay, let's start with the Keras example and the classification example. For that, we can go into our Python code and run our Jupyter notebook. I've already done that because some of those steps will take a little bit of time. So the first exercise is just the version number. If you can run this cell, you can pretty much run every of our Python code. So it should output something like 2.4. The important part is that you at least have version 2 of TensorFlow installed on your notebook. Afterwards, we generate our data. So on this classification data, we want to create some blobs of data. In this part, you can see we have four two-dimensional points. So the first point would be 1 and 1.5, and the second one minus 1, and so on. And each of those four points will be the center of a Gaussian distribution. And each of those distributions has a certain standard deviation. The standard deviations are depicted here. So the first one, for example, has 0.5, the second one 0.75, and so on. And with those values, we can create four normal distributions. And this is done in this line. So we have, for example, the centers that we defined before, also the standard deviation that we defined. In our case, we have a random state because we want to have that your random data is the same as our random data. So you pretty much should have the same picture. And what we also define here are the sample size. So we create different numbers of samples for each of those normal distributions. Afterwards, we just plot the data. This is shown here. We also, because we know which data point is from which standard deviation, we can color those data points. So we see that the first the first normal distribution or one normal distribution is somewhere around minus 2 and minus 7.4. If we look in our centers, that's the last standard deviation. We can also see that this normal distribution has pretty much the smallest standard deviation because all of the points are they're very dense around the center. For example, the right one with the center in somewhat 2.03, the third standard deviation that has a very big standard deviation, and we can also see that here, and we see that the points are spread across a big area. Afterwards, we can create our neural network model in TensorFlow or in Keras, as we use it here. We can do it in very few lines of code. So, and we can see that we have this Keras layers dense parameter and or function. And this will take as an input how many inputs we have. how many dimensions we have in this input, and what activation function we would use. So each of these lines represent a layer. So the first one would be our input layer. Afterwards, we would have an hidden layer that we define with a different activation function. In this case, it's instead of ReLU, it's softmux. And yeah, afterwards we have a small summary what our model have. So we can see we have pretty much two layers and with different size of parameters that we can train. Afterwards, we come to the next step where we configure the learning process. So to train the model, we need to apply different rules how we train this model. In this case, we use Adam as an optimizer, define a special loss function and some metrics. You can play around with those parameters if you Google the model and what they're capable of, and use different types of training optimizer, for example. They are dependent on the data you use, and there you can optimize your neural network later on. Afterwards, we want to split the dataset. So we have a dataset generated that was shown in this picture here, and we want to split the dataset. So in the exercise, I talked already about overfitting. So we need to split the dataset in a certain range that we can prevent overfitting. In our case, we want to split it by the size of 0.3, so 30% of our test of our data, of our whole data, is reserved for testing purposes. Afterwards, we can train our model. Therefore, we use our previously splitted data set. We only use the X and Y train pairs of numbers or points, and we want to train 400 epochs. So we train our model, our neural network, 100 times, and can see that over the time the accuracy rises. So at the start we have very low 0.1, and that starts getting up very quickly. So around after 10 epochs we already have 60% accuracy, and this goes on, and in the end we have some nearly 80% accuracy after 100 epochs. You can play around with parameters. With higher epochs you should get a higher accuracy. But the problem is afterwards that we need to evaluate our model. This is done with our previously splitted test data set. So we see that our model has accuracy on our test set from 75%. What we see is that you have, if you train with many epochs, the accuracy in the training process gets higher and higher. But after a certain while, the test accuracy of the testing set gets lower and lower because we have this overfitting. Afterwards, we can just do a small prediction and have a look what our model would output if we predict a pair. And we can see that we classify some data for the wrong data set. This is shown in the last picture, for example, here. So the red points are the falsely classified points in our data set. Yeah, this should be it for the classification tutorial. The second part is the regression model. In the regression model, we don't have data sets and we don't want to classify a certain set, but we want, for example, we have a function. And we want to see if we can find dependencies on two variables. So for that, we open the second part of our query, of our example. This is a Keras regression tutorial, and it starts the same. So we have also the TensorFlow RPE that we want to look into, which we have. And afterwards, the regression tutorial starts. So we have a data set. In our case, it's a data set of a vector. So our x data is grows from -3 to 3 and has 300 data points in it, and is added with random or normal white noise with the amplitude of 0.2. So we have a noise, a noisy linear vector. What we want to estimate is an exponential function of it. So we use the same dataset in it with a different noise and a different linear gradient, and we want to model this kind of curve that is shown here and below. So when we have our trained model, we have as an input these kind of values, and we want to get as an output an exponential function. And this is our goal for our neural network in this case. What we do here is we train split our data in train and testing data, again with 30% reserved for testing, and can plot the data. And here in red is our test data, so that are the 30% of our points. In blue are our training data that we use for training. And do pretty much the same as in the classification data. So we define our neural network. In this case, we have one input layer, and the input shape is one. So we only get one data point as an input. I have an activation function of 8, and have 8 8 of those perceptrons in our network. The second layer has 4, a depth of 4, and also an activation function of ReLU. And the last output layer has only one output, so we get just one number as an output. So we have the same mapping, one input and one output. So when we look at our XY data, we can see we have in our X data 1 and our Y data also 1 dimension. So we can map it in this fashion. Afterwards, we can train, or we can configure the learning process as before. In this part, we don't use Adam. In this case, we use Adam as prop, but those are smaller details you can play around with if you want to. Afterwards, we train our model. This will take a little bit because we train for 1000 epochs. And we can also see that that our model gets better and better over time. And afterwards, we can evaluate our trained model with our testing data, and we can see that we have 0.14 as a test accuracy. Afterwards, we can again predict some data and look into the deviation of our original data and our predicted data, and we can see in the last picture that we have a pretty okay fit or pretty good fit for our estimated regression data. Okay, and the next part is where you have to do something, or you can do something on your own. So this is the classification exercise, and in this exercise I will go through the first part where you can fill in the gaps. So the classification data is a data set from Keras. It's provided with Keras, and we can look into the first part of it. So again, we have the version 2.4. Afterwards, we can some sort of load the data set. It's called fashion _mnist. And what this dataset is, we can have a look into here. So if you look at the shapes, we can already see that the shapes of the dataset itself is some 60,000 by 28 by 28. So if you look in the documentation, we will see that this fashion data set has pictures of fashion objects, for example, trousers or some sort of clothes and something like that. And those images are 28 pixels by 28 pixels, and we have 30,000 of those training images. We can also look into the shape of the test images. They, of course, have the same pixel dimensions, 28 by 28, and we have 10,000 pictures of those. What we can also do is look at the pixels itself, so we can look at the values that they have. And they range from 0 to 255, so we can see that they are have values, they are grayscale values, so they are not RGB values, only black and white pictures. Afterwards, we can have a look into the labels that are provided with the example. And that have some names, and they have the same dimensions. If you look into them, yeah, they are 60,000. Have the range is 0 to 9, so we have 10 possible values, and these 10 possible labels we can assign. For example, we have a t-shirt, top, trousers, shirt, sandals, and those are the the features that our pictures can depict, and we want to differentiate between those kind of objects. Afterwards, we can plot some of those example pictures, and we can see we have some pullovers, sneakers, trousers, dress. Those are the pictures that we want to classify. And afterwards, it's now your job to fill in the gaps. At the first part, we want to normalize the data. So we already seen that they are from 0 to 255. And we want the output to be from 0 to 1. The next step would be to define our model. So at first, we want to define our input layer. There you can look in the Keras documentation and convert maybe the input to a vector. Afterwards, you can choose one hidden layer with arbitrary size. And the last part is to choose an output layer that has the right size for our output labels to classify everything. Afterwards you have to model or compile the model and can train your model with your chosen network size. And the last part would be to test the model. Let's have a look into the solution. So the first part would be to normalize the images. This is pretty easy because we already know that our image size is from 0 to 255. So we want to just divide by the maximum. So we divide by 255, and now our images have values from 0 to 1. Afterwards, we want to create our model, so our network structure. The first one would be that we want to shape our input vector. So we know we have pictures with 28 by 28 pixels, and neural networks like to have just vectors as input. What we can do is we can convert these images and stack each of those lines as a row. So we have, instead of 28 by 28 two dimensions, only one dimension with 28 by 28 values itself. So we flatten the picture to a vector. Afterwards, we wanted to define a hidden layer. In our case, we just use the activation function ReLU and have 128 outputs. And the last part would be the output layer. So this is defined because we want to classify 10 different items. The output layer needs to have 10 different outputs. So each of those outputs has then a certain probability that the given input is that output. For example, if the first output would be 1 and all other outputs would be 0, we have a 100% classification for an ankle boot in our case. Oh no, the first one would be a t-shirt or top. Yeah. And therefore we have the probability as a vector. Yeah, afterwards we use a very basic classification model that we use for training, and afterwards we train our model and can see that we have after 10 epochs already a accuracy of 91%. Afterwards we test our model and see that we have after with the testing data accuracy of 88%, which is pretty good. Yeah, and this was a small exercise for classification data. Okay, let's have a look at the last part of this exercise, the regression model. For that, you have to open the regression exercise DIY. So at first, I will also talk about the DIY version and talk about this example. So if you run the first cell, it should say 2.4. So we know we can run everything in our Visual Studio. What we provided you with is a data set. So we have a CSV file. If you open this, you will see a lot of data points. Those data set gives an overview of different cars and what MPGs, miles per gallon, they use, which, how many cylinders they have, how many horsepower, weight, acceleration, some data of just different kind of cars. What we want to look into is what kind of correlation these data set or these data vectors, these feature vectors have to another. So we focus on MPGs, the miles per gallon, on different kind of features. So in theory, if you think about it, we should have a higher or lower MPG with a higher cylinder count or higher sort of horsepower, but maybe a higher miles per gallon with also a lower weight. So if we have a very, very light car, we would travel a lot of miles with the same amount of fuel than a heavier car. Yeah, afterwards we want to read in the dataset. This is done with Pandas. Pandas is very good for some sort of CSV files, and we can display it in a very nice way. So we have our table and we see that we have nearly 400 cars in it from the year 70, I don't know, to 82. And yeah, afterwards we can split our data set. So we want to split it in 80% an 80% training data set and test data set. Again, we need or we use a random state, so your data set, your splitted data set is the same as ours. Afterwards, we want to look into the data set that we splitted. So this is a training data set. And we can look into the correlation coefficients of that. So if we look into correlation of the whole data set, we can see that we have on the diagonal always one, because if we correlate MPG with MPG, of course we have 100% correlation. What we can also see is some different kind of cross correlations. So again, if we see some sort of MPG with horsepower, we have a correlation, something like that. Afterwards, we want to split those data sets. So we remove our training set and our testing data set from our normal data set. And now the part starts where you can try and go on your own. In the exercise, there are some suggestions how you design your neural networks. So you have to design your first model in this part. This first part is without normalization. If you defined your model, you can also do afterwards the regression with the normalization. So here we just remove the mean and divide by the standard deviation. So our testing and training set is now normalized. Afterwards, you also have to define your model, and you can have a look into the results of both of those kind of regression with normalization and regression without normalization. The last part is further optimization. So again, here you can define your model that is given, or it's that is given in the task exercise, and also can implement an early stop criterion that I think we also had in one of the examples before, and can look at the results. And the last part would be the final correlation or the final analysis with the correlation of those values. Yeah, when we go to the solution, the first part is pretty much the same. The first thing you should have done is to define the model for the without the normalization part. So in the task, we're given two layers with 64 neurons, so that are defined in these two lines. The first layer is the input layer, so we also have to define the input shape that we want to use, the number of data set keys. The second or the first hidden layer would be also 64 neurons with the ReLU function. And as an output, we want one as an output. So this would be our correlation coefficient. If we train this for 1000 epochs, we can see the model mean square error between the coefficients, and we can see that the mean squared error is nearly 14. If we look at the picture of the training itself, we can see the mean screen error over the different epochs. You can see that it's getting lower, but it needs some time to get this low. The second part was pretty much the same, but with the normalization. So you can also just use the same neural network and see if the input data, if you use the normalization, have an effect on the training and an effect on the output. And what we can see is that the mean screen error over time, or the final mean screen error in the test data, is around 6. That is much better than the regression without the normalization. What we can also see here is a mean screen error over the epochs of time. So we see that we have a very fast convergence of the mean screen error over the time. Afterwards, we can also do further optimization. For that, you had to design your own model. And again, this is the same model as before, so we can compare only the different things that we changed with the same model. Though in this case, we use an early stop, and that early stop will monitor our training process. And we'll stop the training process if it thinks that the training is enough, and if we would train more of our data, the result would get worse. So if we look at the results after that, we can see that we have a better mean squared error of 5.7 against I think 5.996 of the full training. And this is due to this early stopping. So we have to be careful when we train our neural networks, because when we train them too much with too many epochs, we maybe overfit our neural networks. The last part is then the final correlation. Therefore, we can calculate the Pearson correlation of our data. And we can see that we have a result of 95%, which is pretty good. And yeah, this should conclude our exercise with this part. I hope you understood the basic concept of neural network and also can apply those neural networks with, for example, our code with Keras and understand how to apply neural networks.